I strongly believe that the balance between liberty and oppression in our world is ultimately determined by the balance between offensive and defensive technologies. Imagine a world where defensive technology always prevails in every area of human life. Basically, nobody would be able to harm anybody else. Any kind of coercion would be impossible. Imagine the unprecedented level of liberty and security for all. And so, if we want to advance the cause of liberty, we should strive to develop all kinds of defensive technologies. And this is Whisper is all about. So today we're going to talk about achieving darkness with Whisper. So Whisper is a messaging system for distributed applications. And at the most secure mode of operation is supposed to be able to achieve darkness at considerable expense in terms of processor power, bandwidth, etc. So what is darkness? It's a property of the system when no meta information is being leaked. And it goes hand in hand with plausible deniability. For example, if the message is found on your computer, nobody can reasonably assume that this message was addressed to you because this is part of the protocol that the node stores and forwards all the messages. So Whisper was designed to be integral part of Ethereum ecosystem, and it offers off-chain communication between the dApps. So it has nothing to do with blockchain, it's off-chain. And the reason for that is because off-chain communication is much cheaper, and if you don't need consensus, you just need to send a message, you use Whisper. And so Whisper uses underlying Ethereum communication protocol to take care of message delivery. And Whisper is a gossip protocol. It means that every message is delivered to every node. So now we are going to talk about the technical details.
All right, thanks. Yeah, so this represents a network, and you have nodes on the network, obviously. And each node has a key. And if a node at the center wants to send a message to a recipient, what it does is that it encrypts the message with the node's, the recipient's key. And so it will then forward the message to its neighboring nodes. And those nodes will try to decrypt the message. They will fail because they don't have the right key. And they will forward it to their nodes as well, to their neighbors as well. And so on until it reaches the recipient that manages to decrypt the message. You will notice that actually that doesn't stop here. Even though the message has reached its recipient, the recipient will still forward to its neighboring node, and that's to not be identified as the recipient. Otherwise, that would leak metadata. So how do you, these are a lot of messages, how do you prevent people from spamming the network? We use proof of work. I assume I don't have to tell you what it is. But yeah, that's how you throttle the traffic on the network. So there are some advantages to this approach. First, it's decentralized, obviously, because you do not have to send it to one central authority like WhatsApp or Google Talk. You can also agree with the protocol on a protocol with your recipient on how to generate keys, so you do not have to store the keys on disk. And you have two other advantages: well, darkness and steganography. But Vlad will be talking about that later. We were not kidding when we said that would come at a significant cost. The problem of this approach is that it has a high latency, a high bandwidth. Obviously, everybody's sending messages to everybody else. There's a high processor load because you need to try to decrypt messages even if they're not intended for you. And on top of that, you need to keep a copy of the messages in memory because you might be sent messages that you already sent and you do not want to overload the system with sending extra messages. So you need to keep messages in memory a bit longer, and that's costly as well. So the way the message works, we have a time to live and an expiry, which is what I described, how long you should keep the message in memory. You have the nonce, which is related to the proof of work, and you have the encrypted payload, which is the message itself. And we also provide a heuristic to help the nodes determine if it's worth decrypting the message or not, to try to save a bit of a processor load. So this heuristic is called the topics. It's 4 bytes of arbitrary data. It's very short. It's on purpose, and the goal for that is so that you cannot be identified with your topic. So other participants on the node on the network will probably set the same topic, so you will be able to deny that the message was intended for you. In version 6, we also want to let the nodes decide what kind of topics they want to receive, and that will reduce the darkness, but that will also reduce the workload. So it's an help to improve adoption, so that people do not spend as much resources when adopting Whisper. And
So let's talk about achieving darkness. So we should assume that our adversary is very powerful and it owns a lot of nodes on the network, maybe more than half of the entire network. And also it is capable and willing to target individual nodes. So it can brute force generate the Whisper identities of its nodes in such a way that they fit into the network topology, completely surrounding the target node, and with the purpose of performing the traffic analysis. So for recipient, it's quite easy to achieve darkness, because recipient gets all the messages, tries to decrypt them, in case of success, reads the message, and nobody from outside can detect it. The only thing the recipient should take care of is treat all the messages equally. So even those messages he can read should be forwarded. And if you use default implementation of GET, then it's already taken care of. But for the sender, of course, in some cases, the adversary can see that the message was originated in this node. So how to achieve darkness? Well, you can try to maintain certain level of noise. For example, you send messages every so often, and if you have something to say, you encrypt a meaningful message. If not, then you encrypt some random data, and it will be indistinguishable. And also, I would recommend to use different topics and keys and whatnot for incoming and for outgoing messages. Because imagine if you have two nodes on the network, they communicate with each other, so you cannot really detect who communicates with whom unless those two nodes send messages with the same topic, or those messages share other traits, message size, frequency, proof of work, and so on. And so it's better to have that the messages outgoing and incoming don't share common traits. So message size is another important metric which can potentially leak meta information, and that's why we have introduced the padding field. So imagine that you have you maintain a certain level of noise, so you send messages every so often, and every message is approximately 1 kilobyte, and then all of a sudden you need to send a short message, like in this case, goodbye big brother, and then it's very different. So what you can do, you can randomly generate some data and put into the padding field, and then you encrypt the entire message, and those fields are indistinguishable, and so you can adjust the message size. And our default implementation already includes that. So every message has size which is a factor of 256 bytes. But our API allows easy access to this field, so you can actually set any size you want. Also, our default implementation allows symmetric and asymmetric encryption for messages. In case of symmetric encryption, if you engage in this communication with somebody else, it means that you have already exchanged the secret key through some kind of secure channel. And I would recommend to use exactly the same channel, whatever it is, to exchange also the topics and all the other related information. And it's easy. But for asymmetric encryption, what usually happens is you advertise your public key in some open channel, and you probably are not willing to publish the topic, because in this case, message sent with this topic, adversary can guess that the message was addressed to you. So, but if you try to decrypt all the incoming messages, it might be too expensive in terms of processor power. So what you can do, you can require higher proof of work for messages without the topic. And also you can advertise partial topics. So for example, you say, if the first byte of the topic contains certain value, for example, zero, then you will try to decrypt this message. I would also recommend to use the long-term keys only to establish the session. So you generate session keys for outgoing and incoming messages, you generate the topics, preferably randomly, and you send the first message to establish the session, and this message will be encrypted with the long-term key, and then you proceed to communicate normally with ephemeral keys, and after the session is over, the keys are deleted, and nobody will be able to decrypt those messages again, if you don't store them. So another important thing in our implementation is steganography support. So we have this padding field, and normally it's generated randomly, but our API allows easy access to this field. So what you can do, you can substitute the padding with some secret message. For example, you have some secret message, in this case lorem ipsum, and then you encrypt the message with some completely different key. You put the encrypted message in the padding field, then you compose some innocent looking message, like in this case, I have nothing to hide, and then you encrypt everything, and yeah, you get the encrypted message. And so in the future, if your communication is compromised, or worse, if the adversary will force you to reveal your long-term key, then adversary will decrypt the message and they will see this innocent-looking part and random-looking payload. And they cannot reasonably assume that this message, this padding field contains some secret message, because all the whisper messages contain this padding field. So we are officially implementation agnostic. So what you can do with our implementation of Whisper, you can set up your own private network. And it has a number of advantages. First of all, in private network, you may have only trusted participants, so you don't expect any spam, and therefore you don't need any proof of work requirements, so you can abandon that. And also the number of nodes is relatively low, so you don't have bandwidth constraints, and so you will not have latency. And you can engage in instant messaging, you can engage in voice calls, video calls, whatever. And the only thing the adversary can say about the participant is that they part of this network. And in case of some organizations, it's already known. Also, some people ask me if it's possible to use the custom encryption instead of Whisper encryption because they don't trust our Whisper encryption. And I'm always happy to see, to hear such questions because it shows that people are serious about security. And the answer is that you cannot substitute Whisper encryption by the custom encryption, but you can encrypt on top of our default implementation, and our API allows easy access to do it. And in cryptographic community, it's usually discouraged to use custom encryption. But in this case, if you do it on top of our Whisper encryption with unrelated keys, you can do no harm. And I actually want to encourage people to continue research and development in encryption because, first of all, we should not be complacent. And on the other hand, it's looking very promising. Actually, this is the first time in history that certain technology, namely cryptography, offers such a huge advantage to the defenders over those who try to attack. And of course, all kind of self-appointed busybodies are going to be very unhappy about it because they see the writing on the wall that technology makes them obsolete and they will no longer be able to control the free speech and all the king's horses are not going to help them. And if you hear them saying that encrypted communication is very dangerous, and especially if they advertise their services to protect you from those dangers, just remember that we are talking about very peaceful technology here, which can be used solely and exclusively for defensive purposes. So here are our contact details. Please join our Gitter channel or write to us on Gitter, and we will be very happy to assist, especially if your project seems to contribute to the cause of liberty. So we, of course, cannot help everyone, but yeah, we will try to assist Whisper integration with any substantial project. And yeah, now we have a little bit of time, so maybe we'll take a couple of questions.
Daniel.
I would like to ask, how can a node control how much of their own time they want to drop on to Whisper? Is it solely by setting the threshold for the proof of work getting forward?
So one is the proof of work, and in Whisper version 6 is going to be dynamic. So you can dynamically set proof of work, and if traffic is too high, you can increase it on the fly. But also we will have Bloom filter exchange protocol for the topics, and so you will be able to set up those Bloom filters in such a way that you can probabilistically assess how many messages you get. For example, you want to reduce your traffic by 90%, and there will be formula how you can set the Bloom filter.
Right.
Yeah, please. Sorry? So.
Yeah. Yeah, can you repeat the question, please?
How do you access the system? Just using a normal email? So if I just want to get some protection in my normal email, can I use this for doing it?
Can you answer?
No, sorry. it's a bit embarrassing, but could you please repeat slowly?
So I'm an Australian, so yeah. Put all my words together in one sentence. So,
no worries, mate.
So if I'd like to use this to protect my standard email, and I want to access this level of protection with my emails. Mm-hmm. How do I do that?
Right.
I guess it's a question for the DApp developers. So those DApps who use Whisper for their communication, they should take care of that. Maybe there will be some DApps which provide email-like service based on Whisper. And maybe it's going to be status, maybe somebody else. So we hope, it's going to happen.
Okay, so I'm just, I'm developing a D app that's going to have a front end in JavaScript connecting with Ethereum. So are you kind of envisaging that this gets implemented in a front end Java library to communicate with other peers around the network?
So you want to use the, I didn't quite hear, so you want to use the JavaScript library?
So I'm asking, where are you seeing this, this protocol being implemented on what kind of level of the stack? At right. The front end, or how can you use this in the back end library?
So you have an RPC interface, so you could, you have a JavaScript, it's part of a Web3. So you can always communicate with that, but under the cover, under the hood, it's RPC call, so you can just send the HTTP request. So if you want to implement it in backend, you can do it this way. And if you need a specific a library for a specific language, you can always contact us. I mean, we're willing to help.
Great speech. So I guess my question is, can this decentralized system be used for something outside of Ethereum? Like, if I wanted to build out a messaging app that takes advantage of all the benefits of the system, can I somehow utilize that? Like, Android, iOS messaging app, that'd be pretty cool. Yeah.
So, as I mentioned before, officially we are implementation agnostic. So you can even deploy your private Whisper network and use it for whatever purposes you see fit. And yeah.
So you may not be able to answer this, but is there any risks associated with ultimate liberty? And also, is it entirely a defensive technology because of the fact that people could use negative conspiracy and non-repudiation and some of these other tools to communicate and basically conspire?
Yeah, so they can even use it to spread heresy, apostasy, and all kind of dangerous things. And why I mentioned those quasi-religious things is because government usually uses those.
So people didn't conspire before government?
Yeah.
So my answer is that people did conspire and people did commit a lot of crime, and they use all kind of stuff to do it, roads and cars and whatnot. And so this is what we are doing. This is purely defensive technology. You cannot use it to attack somebody. You can use it to defend yourself, even if you're a criminal or if you're a normal person. You can only use it to defend yourself. And whatever the people will later say that is aggressive and whatnot, it's obvious that it's purely defensive, right?
All right. I suggest you come to us and we'll have a longer debate because we are running out of time and we have one more question.
How much can we expect the network to scale with our current computational resources, of the home users? In terms of how many nodes can we run so it's feasible for the network to support all that traffic?
Yeah, we're actually working on that one. it's pretty, right now, given the protocol, it's still really, really, really high. The load is really high. So the scaling is still a problem, and this is why we're going to introduce V6. So we don't have numbers yet, but if you're interested, we can keep in touch, and I'll send you the results when we start developing it.
Thank you.